So we have with us Rahul from Shemaroo, Pawan from Nagio, and Jasrita from Fortis Healthcare. So now as I sit here with these domain experts from the marketing and communication industry, I'm reminded of this one quote, which was something like this, you can change your world by just changing your words. And that's exactly what this industry has been doing all these decades, shaping, polishing, and if need be, even airbrushing the communication of brands. So what are we here to discuss today? The new age marketing and communication. So let me start with asking a very basic question to our panelists here. You know, what is that one sweeping change that the advent of digital has brought about in the communication and marketing industry? Let's start with you, Jasrita.
Sure. One broad sweeping change that I can talk about is that I think it has thrown out of the rule book what, as a brand and communication professionals, you were told, which is you have the power to build your brand narrative. Okay, so a brand is no longer what we tell the people it is. The brand is now what consumers tell one another that it is. So I think that is a broad change, and that has happened with the advent of digital, especially social media, where there are no walls.
Yeah, I think it's been the most disruptive thing that has happened to any industry in last many, many decades. And it's definitely for the good of a lot of industries, especially for if we talk about communication. It gives us so much opportunity to reach out to consumers where they want to see what they want to see. You can hyper-target and reach out to a very specific niche audience, what you want to tell them, and not just a one-way communication, but have a real two-way communication with so many of your fans across the globe, and take feedback and continuously improve what you're trying to deliver to them.
So I think I'll speak from the perspective of the industry I represent. So Shemaroo actually is a media and entertainment company, India's one of the oldest media and entertainment companies in India. And about a year and a half ago, we sort of changed our brand imagery to become more relevant to consumers. Being in the content industry, what digital has done actually is digital has made the consumers themselves create content now. So it's not just the role of content companies like us to create content. That has driven a lot of conversations, and which also helps us to up our game in the content we create. What I think Pawan spoke about is a two-way communication which is happening. It's happening in various forms. It's happening either with the content being put up by a user. It's happening, but unlimited to and fro information messaging happening. So yeah, digital has been disruptive for a lot of us, and actually it's sort of is blurring the lines between marketing and PR very, very strongly now.
So I'd just like to add here, so because Rahul spoke about content. So it also gives you so much more to do with your own content. So to give you an example, a couple of years back, we launched this show called One Strange Rock with Will Smith as the host of the show. And that was a 10-episode series which was going to be launched across television screens across the world. But we partnered with Instagram, and they saw the merit in partnering with us in launching a new service on the Instagram platform called Instagram TV. And we hosted the first Instagram TV content globally live, which was a live chat between Will Smith and the astronauts on International Space Station. And that became such a viral moment, right? So the format was that Will Smith is going to be doing a live chat with these astronauts, but at the same time, the people on the platform could send in their questions to Will Smith and interact with the astronauts and really create content right from that moment. So while we were promoting a show, which was a totally different thing, we ended up creating a new service with a platform like Instagram.
Another thing I think digital has done, and I hate saying this as a journalist, is reduce the dependence of brands on journalists. Now you have different ways to communicate with the user directly. And while it's good that you can get the response real time, it also works in a different way. You can get trolled just as much. You know, Mr. Ghosh was here, and I remember this one example by Indigo, where a user also put up this video of this Indigo crew bashing up or manhandling this passenger, and it went viral, and it really was a PR disaster. So how do you, in such a case, you know, handle this double-edged sword called digital?
I think you rightly said it. You set the context that it is a double-edged sword. So the way that it has democratized the whole landscape is a good thing, because now there is no concentration of power with a few people. Mm. So there is no concentration of power. If we borrow from Rajdeep's example in the keynote address, that there is a Mr. Girilal Jain who seems to be the only guy who has a direct line to, let's say, the PM or of that. Today, everyone who follows a political party or a leader's Twitter handle has a direct line to it. You know, so this whole democratizing of the space, bringing down the walls, and this concentration of power to decentralization of power, where everyone has a voice, is a good thing. I think it's a good thing for everyone. It's a good thing for consumers, of course. It's also a good thing for corporations and for people such as ourselves, because that's a check. That's a check so that we don't become heady, so that we're not drunk on power, so that we don't think we are any more important than we are, right? So I think all good in that space. But as you mentioned, it's a double-edged sword. It's a double-edged sword, especially for few industries. So if I can speak about healthcare, it's very difficult to lose a loved one. And when you lose a loved one, the first thing is to go on Twitter and say, hey, there was medical negligence. Or, you know, so, and the kind of vandalism.
Comes a lot more personal anger.
A lot of personal angst and a lot of mob mentality. So how do you control that is also, you know, very, very difficult. And I think the basic tenets of crisis communication and crisis containment, whether it is digital or not, still hold good. The only thing that has changed is the alacrity and the speed with which you sort of respond. So listen to what's happening. I would say, you know, put out a hold to all your other promotional communication going on, because if it is crisis, then you don't want to talk about, you know, hey, buy this or, you know, go there. And at the same time, put a real narrative. And if you have some people, third party, who can sort of, I think endorse is not the right word, but at least say that, yes, you know, I know for a fact, or I have seen this for a fact, or I witnessed it, or here's the other side of the perspective. If you can put that out and be available, don't switch off your phones. Do not, you know, yes, be available. Don't switch off your phones and do not say, I will not respond to the negative narrative. All of us are not just brand people, we're also consumers. You know, if you want to go for a holiday, I'm sure everybody goes on TripAdvisor. I, for one, am very critical of a brand which has only positives for it. Somebody's been, you know, doing something at the back end. And you know, nobody likes double smart people today. So a healthy balance of negative is also right, as long as you've acknowledged it and you've responded it. So net-net, before I let my other colleagues come in, be responsive as a brand. Be responsible as a brand. Be sensitive to the negative out there. Don't be a troll yourself. And I think eventually, sense will prevail.
Yeah, I think if we have to talk about this, really, truly a double-edged sword. While it is a problem, and I think troll armies are everywhere now, you have to be really careful what you're putting out there, especially on the digital platforms. But at the same time, it's also an opportunity for a lot of brands. Like, I can talk from my personal experience on National Geographic. So we have a very dedicated fan base, if I can call them that, right? People who really believe in the purpose of for the brand. And it actually goes down to the basics of communication, that be consistent. So we've been very consistent on what we stand for. And that's the reason that we have been able to aggregate a community of like-minded people. And if someone has an issue or someone raises something negative, then we have cultivated that community to come and rescue us or respond on our behalf, because they know what this brand stands for. We have enough and more touch points with them, and we have been consistent in our messaging throughout the years, and we're talking decades and decades of communication through different platforms, so that we have created those dedicated fan base that they will come to your rescue. So you don't have to, in our experience, we luckily enough, we don't have to really go out and defend ourselves. We've had those brand ambassadors or fans who help us rescue from those situations. So firstly, it did not come wrapped in a plastic cover in India. This was just one market where the magazine was distributed by a licensor in Brazil, where the magazine got sent in that plastic wrap. So, of course, this was, again, one of those moments where literally, if you go down, scroll down to your timeline to that moment, you will not see an official response from the brand. And you will see thousands and thousands of people talking about that. It's what the message is that matters. It's not what the... Because they know that National Geographic is not the brand that is going to preach something and do something else. They know that the intention is right, that we are trying to raise up a very relevant issue. And we all know that when we started this conversation back in 2017, from there till now, we have like really come a long distance. We've got a lot of governments involved. We've got a lot of business leaders involved in the, into the conversation. So it just shows that because we were true to the purpose of the brand, this is what we stand for. So it doesn't really matter if you've really slipped or missed on one or two points here and there, right? Because we had the support of our true believers, our brand fans. They are the ones who actually were responding on our behalf.
Rahul, you'd like to say something?
Yeah, I think you know what you raised about you know digital now being a double-edged sword, especially in the comm space. I think personally for me, I think I sleep better because I don't have to wait for the next day paper to know what's happening to my brand conversation. We are tracking the brand 24/7. We pretty much know exactly what direction we are heading towards. You know, there are tools which actually have been built AI to even predict where your conversation could go on digital. So, you know, you essentially keep mapping your, you know, so in my mind, you know, brands don't go viral, emotions go viral. So you keep mapping emotions, essentially. And you take opportunities to convert negative to positive. At the right time, you know, it could be done with, you know, compassion, humor, many, many ways. And those conversations really, really stay, have a larger impact than most marketing messages do. When you actually address to the right, you know, you've lost a loved one, you know, how do you handle it? The way you handle it, the person's yours for a lifetime. He's with your brand forever. So for me, I think the double-edged sword is a good thing to do. Actually, yeah.
Like you mentioned, you know, if you handle it the correct way, the brand, the customer is yours forever. Probably something like what Zomato did. Maybe when the delivery boy, that tweet was put up and they said, food has no religion. I mean, they really won everybody over with that one comment. So I think that works. Okay, so another thing
or when they said that even our delivery boys could be hungry, you know, or when Vistara just said that even our crew, you know, they work the day and night round and they have a right to say. So I think even as brands, when somebody is trolling you, you know, in this age of where everyone has a microphone in their hands, for whether it's a emotion or it's the values that you stand for, whatever you stand for, your purpose, taking a stand is also very good. Because that shows you as a humane side. It just, you know, humanizes the entire brand conversation.
Another product of the digital age is influencers. While there's a lot of debate about, you know, fake followers and all of that, you know, how good do you think are influencers for a brand, you know? They end up endorsing multiple things. Do you think they lose their credibility in the process?
So, again, it depends on what your brand is trying to do. If you're looking at a reach metric, you know, you're at a stage when you want to reach out to more and more people, you know, you want people to just know about your product. Great, you know, you can use as many influencers as you want. People will see what your product is. They may not form an opinion as early, they just know about your product. But yeah, the stage when you have to actually create that emotion again, when you actually want them to, consumers to move up the triangle and actually look at the brand more than saliency, I think at that stage, I think choosing the right influencer and the medium, because influencers exist everywhere. It's just not limited to digital. You know, you have influencers and even on television. So choosing the right medium and the right influencer is very, very critical. But I will still stick to the fact that it's about what your KPI is at that stage, and then you choose your right way forward on that.
So influencers is a very, I think, important tool in a marketer's arsenal in today's day and age. And I have seen a lot of brands use it in a very powerful way. And if I talk specifically about what we have done in past couple of months itself, so on 2nd of October this year, we thought that we'll just make the plastic conversation really big again. And I know that if we would have just relied on our brand handles and our marketing support, we won't have been able to actually reach out to a much larger base without spending the kind of money. But what ended up happening was we just got in touch with certain Bollywood celebrities, and of course it was the messaging on plastic, so hence they were happy to partner with us. And we started actually creating a campaign where we started tagging political leaders through the Bollywood celebs. And what it did was a ripple effect of conversations and people taking up notice who generally would not have been a part of my conversations around plastic. But on that particular day, we had a potential reach of some 0.8 billion impressions within a span of 24 hours. And what we did was we asked people to come and take a pledge that they are going to reduce their plastic consumption on a daily basis on our website. And within a span of 24 hours, some 25 million plastic items were pledged. So, and it was all on the back of just an influencer campaign. It wasn't that we didn't really did Facebook ads, we didn't run any video commercials, we didn't even create a communication around it. It was just the pure messaging that influencers put out there.
So I can elucidate with help of an example. Mental health concerns are very widespread today. So we did this campaign, which is hashtag unmute yourself. And that is just to say that, you know, when you're suffering from any sort of psychological issue, you feel that your voice is muted, that your feelings are muting. So hashtag unmute yourself. There are two types of influencers that we sort of employed for it. One is people who've gone through that experience themselves, right? So these are influencers not because they have reach, not because they have influencer clout or base, but strip it down and to the basics, these are people who have faced that problem, so nobody can better articulate it. And therefore, in terms of the whole word of mouth thing, where you want to go to somebody who's experienced your product or service, so to say, speaking a marketer's language, here are the people who've gone through it, and therefore are the best, you know, sort of people to speak about it. So those are one set of people that we employed. Secondly, we tagged those Hollywood stars, Bollywood celebrities who've spoken up against or, you know, are running an NGO for that. And then you don't have to say that I'm going for the number A, the A category. You have to go for people who feel for that cause, you know, who feel authentic. So therefore, as long as we keep the conversation authentic and relevant, influencers, I think, is a great, to add to his point, a great point to have in a marketer's and a communicator's arsenal.
I spoke touched briefly upon the fake followers part of it. I was doing this one story on influencer marketing, and I rang up this one company, and the going rate for about 10,000 likes and 10,000 followers is about 7,000 rupees. So this, and it's legit business in India, by the way. So if that is the case, you know, how do you weed out the, you know, the real influencers from the others? And is that why the macro versus micro influencers debate has come into the picture? Do you prefer going with people who have like 1,500 following as opposed to, you know, the lakhs and lakhs of followers?
Which is exactly the point that I was trying to make, Neeta, that I think we don't get swayed, at least in the healthcare industry, and I can speak for the industry, by just the reach. It's not some mad numbers that you're showing. It's the impact that you have, and therefore keep it authentic and relevant, which means if you have gone through a mental health concern yourself, then I don't have to make that tweet and give it to you, okay? And I don't have to run the risk of you've just copy-pasted some stupid content and have to do that. You've gone through it, and you're the best person to articulate it. And somebody who's facing the same issue will resonate with you when he or she reads about it. So therefore, for us, I think it's more important the impact that you will have and not the reach. And if there is a question between the two, toss up between the two, we always go for impact because that keeps the conversation authentic and relevant and not a reach.
Yeah, And with influencers and everything, I'd like you to answer. Do you think there's a problem of plenty in the sense there are too many mediums out there, there are too many different platforms, Instagram, Snapchat, Facebook, you know, where all do you tap your customers?
Well, most definitely, it is a big problem, but at the same time, there are two sides to every coin. So this is a boon for a lot of new age brands who may not have the big budgets and deep pockets to establish their brand in a very short span of time. We've seen so many new brands like, let's say, Oyo, right? Even before they would have started marketing themselves, Oyo was a brand in millions of hearts. Because of these new platforms, what these new brands get an opportunity to reach out to the right segment audience and create a meaningful conversation, be it news outlets or be it influencers or be it social media platforms or just video platforms nowadays, right? If you are able to, if you understand the value proposition of your product and your brand and you really know who you want to talk to, you can really create a meaningful conversations and engagement out of these mini platforms or mini communities out of these social media platforms. And at the same time, for bigger brands, which would earlier consider 500 GRP as the mark for any launch or any new campaign, it becomes, again, a double-edged sword. Sometimes we feel that we have to compete a lot more, we have to invest a lot more in trying to make the message cut through to the right audiences. But at the same time, what it also gives us an opportunity, if you understand what you're trying to do, what you're trying to communicate, then you can go to that right medium and have a much more deeper and meaningful impact.
Basically, you don't miss the good old days of just television, radio and print. I'm happy.
Of course, I miss it because being a television network, we of course miss all the monies that were just parked for our network. But now it's divided amongst a lot more players. But from a marketer, when I put on a marketer's hat, I see there are a lot of advantages also of having so many platforms.
What do you think, Rahul?
Oh, I think it's a great medium. But I also, from my experience, you know, we only go to influencers when I have a campaign. You know, I think influencers should be used, utilized, and you know, you should have a sense of co-working with influencers on a long-term basis to see benefits coming out. If you do it very sporadically, you just do one influencer campaign and disappear, and you go on TV, you go on radio, then you come back to influencers again, you essentially miss out on the benefits you can reap from actually having a longer association with influencers. So in a way, they become your brand ambassadors. So I firmly believe that, you know, having a long-lasting relationship with influencers is a better way. It sort of helps your brand get the right boost.
You know, a basic complaint I think PR agencies have with marketers is that they feel they don't value them enough. You know, simply because, you know, the work, the kind of work they do, it gets reflected long term. You wouldn't really see immediate results for a PR campaign. So do you think in this new age, there are better ways to measure, get better ROI and, you know, measure it through, you know, PR campaigns that way? Do you think we've evolved that on that side?
So again, I take a leaf out of what Rajdeep was saying in his keynote address, that I think so far we've operated in these silos and we've spoken at each other, not with one another. So I think this conversation is happening now. These silos are sort of dissolving and it's a good conversation happening today with the advent of social media. You can look at how many people engage with a particular story. Even if you put out something on online PR, you know how many people that you reached, which is certainly better than just somebody telling you, you know, 10 years back that this is the circulation figure into 4 or 5 formula, this is your readership number. So these many people might have had the opportunity to read your story, okay? At least today, I know that on the page, when I put out a piece of content, how many people have liked it, shared it, commented on it, how many other networks, so it's certainly better. But have we reached a stage where for every, you know, brand manager, it is part of the brand track, you know? We haven't reached that stage. So I think it's a journey and it's all moving in the right direction.
So I feel that, of course, there's been miles and miles that we still have to go, but we've come a very long way in terms of putting a number or putting a metric to what is working, what is not working. I think that right now we are in a space that there is a problem of plenty. There are a lot of indexes, there are a lot of metrics that a brand manager is thrown at, and you necessarily don't know the right benchmarking. You don't know, okay, is if an article is shared 1,000 times, is that enough, or does it have to be 10,000 times? Or if I'm getting 5 comments, is that well enough on this issue? So what the need is to actually, there are enough and more data points out there, but really create the right benchmarking for the right conversations, which is going to define that, okay, what should one expect out of a campaign? So, but at the same time, we've definitely come a long way in terms of identifying some kind of, putting a number to whatever you're doing. Now, someone needs to tell you if that number is well enough or not.
One last question. Time is up, I see. Rahul, I'd like you to answer that. You know, would you say that PR and marketing today are in, like, you know, lines are blurring between them? More and more overlap is happening?
Yeah, I think it's very evident, actually. So, you know, traditionally, marketing would enable sales. And, you know, PR would sort of enable your imagery with the stakeholders. With both of them sort of joining so closely, I think I don't see many companies which keep a very big distinction between comms and marketing. A lot of times, actually, especially for Shemaroo, because we just underwent a recent brand fresh, a lot of initiatives actually are PR-driven, which then get marketed out. So we're trying to do the reverse right now. We actually are very, very PR-focused, and it's working very well for us. So comms is a mainstay for us.
I hope I can successfully conclude that, you know, by giving you a very lame metaphor, I just thought of one. PR and marketing were initially like Paleji and Chai, but now it's more like that solid that dissolves at the bottom of your cup. They're inseparable. So I hope we can... Super. Thank you so much. Thank you.